Good afternoon and welcome to the relaunch of the Defense Studies Department Research Seminar Series. So this is the inaugural session with Professor Mikkel Rasmussen from the University of Copenhagen, talking on Ukraine war and Western way forward, risk management of remote warfare. Now, I'm really pleased that Professor Rasmussen could join us, also in person, obviously because his book on this society, war, terror, technology and strategy in the 21st century is really unique in a way that applies to this society concept. So that's this society, societies that understand and reflect themselves through risk to strategy. And in that sense, it sort of challenges the dominant ends mean rationality of strategy fundamentally. So that's one aspect. His most recent book, Military's Business, Designing Military Power for the Future, does the same thing. It challenges the modern organizational construct of modern militaries, fundamentally asking questions about how is the system, how should the system be redesigned? That in a sense, innovation is all about organizational change rather than technology, for example. So I'm really pleased, Professor Rasmussen has been before twice to the JCC, talking to the means module as part of the advanced and staff course. He also was the expert reviewer for our new MSc in defense innovation, as also the external examiner for the MSc. So this is, as I said, a really great opportunity to hear his new thoughts on the subject. So a very warm welcome and thank you very much. And look forward to the presentation, the questions and the discussions.
Well, thank you, Mark, and thank you for having me, and thank you for coming to all of you present and those of you you online. It's great to be back here. It's one thing to sit and read all those exam papers. It's great to meet the people grading them as well as the students. So thank you again, and also thank you for helping me out in getting to grips with what is happening on the Ukraine front. I think obviously what is going on in European security at the moment is a huge political and social challenge, especially if you live in Ukraine. But it's also a challenge for the way we understand, engage with, and research European security matters. And as Mark mentioned, I have been trying to investigate the use of military force and the organization of military force from a risk perspective. And it seems to me that there's a lot of those thoughts which actually offer some reflection on Western strategy in relation to Ukraine, and perhaps also offers some reflections on the things we have been doing for the last 2 years, why some of them are effective and perhaps some of them are less so. Considerations which I think is hugely important at a time where everyone seems to be considering what the next steps are in Ukraine. So what I would like to talk to you about for the next 30 minutes or so, and then I hope we can have a discussion, is the way in which Western support for Ukraine is a continuation of the Western way of warfare, as it has played out after the end of the Cold War. In many ways, there's a lot of the ways in which the West has engaged in that particular conflict, which are actually perhaps not as new as they are often presented, I would argue. But also that this reflects a theory of operations which are basically based on managing risks rather than a theory of victory. And based on that, I would argue that it tells us something not only about the war in Ukraine, but also the way in which we have conducted operations for the last 20 years, and I call that the remote warfare intervention system. I think it also sheds some insights in the way modeling and simulation AI are used as a risk management tool, the way in which Ukraine has actually become kind of a living lab for using AI in military operations and planning. And I think the result of that is a focus on operations rather than strategy. And that means that the West has had a focus on risk management, which in fact, one may argue, makes it difficult for Ukraine to win the war, or at least win the war on the terms the Ukrainian government would like to win it. In 2021, when the US decided to withdraw from Afghanistan and all Western military contributions and other from Kabul was evacuated in a way that perhaps didn't reflect all that well on Western planning and ways to organize the use of military force. At that point, there was a belief in government offices and outside that we had come to a turning point in the public's belief that Western forces were actually ever able to deliver a decisive military results. There was a huge discussion about whether the way President Biden had decided to withdraw the United States and its allies had actually undermined the Western alliance, whether it actually proved that a 20 years investment in Afghanistan hadn't really paid off. There was a disenchantment with the way the West had conducted military operations after the end of the Cold War. And then Ukraine happened. And suddenly that narrative was turned around. The West was able to provide a unified political effort, or at least an effort unified enough to surprise people in a positive way. When the invasion happened, most people would have expected the Ukrainian forces to be overrun by Russia. That didn't happen either. So a narrative quickly formed, which goes something like this. When push comes to shove, Western technology, Western battle management systems will actually prevail. We might be arguing with one another from time to time, but look, when it actually is important to support the defense of the free world, then we can actually pull it off. And for some time, perhaps the first 2 years of the Ukrainian war, this has been the storyline you hear politicians do speeches about, the analysis you read newspapers and so on. Basically, a belief that okay, it might have been that what we were doing in the global war on terror after 9/11 in Iraq and Afghanistan in the end didn't work out the way we wanted to. Going back to more conventional warfare actually saved us from all of that, and now we know what to do, and we just have to invest the pounds, the dollars, and the euros necessary, then it will be done. And I think in many ways, something like that happened. The Ukrainian army demonstrated a heroic effort where they were able to, against most odds, to fight back the Russians. It's also true that Western technology proved its worth. It's also true that NATO and the EU was able to operate together. But the notion that this is something very different from what we have been doing in Iraq and Afghanistan is something I think you want to look at one more time. Most of you would know Jeffrey Parker defined the Western way of warfare in terms of technology, discipline, and aggressive military tradition, egotism, and finance. A focus which Victor Dave Hansen has elaborated on, talking about the Western focus from the Greeks onwards on fighting decisive battles. And this notion of a Western way of warfare, a particular way in which the West has been not only fighting wars, but also organizing them into forces to engage in warfare, financing them, and so on, is very much part and parcel of how we look at the way Western military forces engage themselves. And part of that narrative I talked about before, about how the Battle of Kiev demonstrated what the West was actually able to do. When we had to, harks back to this notion that this is a Western way of warfare, and that way of warfare is somehow to what other people might how other people might fight. And of course, the beauty of the Western way of warfare is that the countries the West are fighting are almost always defined as non-Western. So this seems to prove that the Russians certainly wasn't a Western nation because they didn't fight as well, always the same planning artillery as the Ukrainian did on our behalf. And if you follow on from that line of argument, then you might argue that there is a post-Cold War Western way of warfare. And that is basically defined by risk management.
Welcome,
So how does that Western way of warfare work? Well, I think it's about a number of issues loosely combined into some kind of paradigm by which Western forces has been engaged in various types of operations, large and small, since the end of the Cold War. Technology is a very important part of this. The development of drone technologies and other standard weapons, which makes it has increasingly made it able for Western military forces to engage in what some describe as remote warfare, the ability to strike over the horizon at targets, not having to send large forces to engage in a particular country. There's a level of institutionalization. The way in which NATO's or other Western coalitions has been important for organizing and supplying troops and material for conducting these operations. There's an element of what Christoph Kroger described as humane warfare, that is a focus on even if we are fighting on distance, even if we are using a significant firepower. Sorry?
No question.
Oh, you were just... yeah, okay. Even if we are using significant firepower against people who might not have as much firepower themselves, there is a focus, perhaps because of that, on international law, humanitarian law, and target selection in humanitarian ways. Increasingly, during the global war on terror, especially the Americans developed a larger modeling capacity for getting various sources of intelligence combined in ways where target selecting was easier, and that just further that technological development where you could rely on remote warfare technology. And all of this done on the basis of increasingly lower defense budgets, which initially was to a large extent financed by a material surplus from the Cold War, but then there was a belief in this paradigm that you could actually defund defense while at the same time investing in new technology, which would enable certain types of operations, but of course underfunding others. And all of this kind of adds up to not a focus on battles, but a focus on operations, a focus on continuous warfighting in areas where you perhaps not believe that it would actually be able to produce those kind of Greek battles, which Hansen imagines, but a continuous low-level engagement where victory doesn't really seem to be the point, but where the point seems to be to be able to suppress the enemy's ability to predict power against you. So if you are bombing in Yemen, it's because you don't want the local militia to be able to fire missiles at the international shipping in the Red Sea. It's not because you basically want to produce some kind of decisive outcome. So that's basically the way the West has been fighting traditionally, and the way we have been fighting during the post-Cold era. And if I just may focus a little bit more on the system created in that way of warfare, which you might want to call the remote warfare intervention system, then that is, as I mentioned before, basically a risk strategy. It's a way to make sure that you can continue to do military operations. To a very large extent, this paradigm is actually about making it possible to use military force in an environment where the use of military force is basically challenged, where it is in that post-Cold War world, increasingly controversial to use military force. The whole humane warfare paradigm seems to indicate that perhaps war isn't humane. And that trying to use military force is something which should be under so much scrutiny that it is actually not possible to do so. And that constitutes a risk for the remote, which you might not be allowed to. So by using remote technologies, by focusing on intelligence, and also by conducting operations which are not in the traditional sense of the term, you aren't in fact offsetting that political risk with an operational pattern which can work within a certain political framework. So these operations are below the threshold of all-out war. But they are also interesting based on the idea that you can model the target society. The traditional Western way of warfare, with that decisive battle where you fight on the battlefield and then one of the parties give up and you have won and you can set the conditions afterwards, that kind of ideal type of war fighting doesn't apply here at all. But you still want to influence outcomes by using military force, otherwise it wouldn't make much sense. So what you are trying to do is to identify the right targets to get the outcome you want. And that might be that car with the terrorist leader and the bomb maker driving down the road, which you then target. Or it might be the insertion of special forces somewhere. There are many different techniques to do this, but it is basically based on the premise that you can kind of model your opponent or your opponent's society and then identify those instances or those key targets which you can target, and by doing so you can achieve outcome. So it's based on the premise that you can kind of model the societies in which you intervene. And this way of thinking in terms of targeting and modeling opposing societies, of course, has a long backstory, starting with strategic bombing during the Second World War and with effects-based operations in the 1990s. But that's basically the premise for doing the remote warfare intervention system. It's a system which can be modeled, and based on that model, you can identify an operational path. And this is basically what we find in the Western approach to the Ukraine war after the first few months. Prime Minister Sunak put it very clearly when he said, if we give President Zelensky the tools, then the Ukrainians will finish the job. In other words, we have an idea about how the job ought to be done. There are certain tools which can make that realize that job. So in other words, if we got just provide them the means, then the ends will follow. And those tools are, of course, the exact same tools which are part of the warfare intervention system, drones, artillery, and so on. But it very quickly became clear that if you were to provide those tools in order for the Ukrainians to do the job, then you also had to do a bit more modeling. You had to be a bit more sure on what was actually going on, not only in the Ukrainian armed forces, which you were giving the tools, and were they actually able to use them in the way you intended, but would they also be able to use them against Russians? You had to model the Russians as well, and you had to model the interaction. So quickly, what became part of the Western contribution was not only artillery shells, it was not only tanks and eventually aircraft, it was basically software. Again, that followed very closely from the remote warfare model, which is in many ways has increasingly become software based. So some of the very first people on the ground in Kyiv in March 2022 was nice people from the US providing software. And because the war continued perhaps longer than many expected, the need for modeling the Ukrainian needs, but also a need for modeling the war itself, grew. And a lot of our debate about how to help Ukraine, what Ukraine actually need in order to prevail, but also whether you can receive have one outcome or the other in the war, are to a very large extent based on either the modeling you do in a newspaper office or think tank, or the modeling you can do inside the defense establishments helping the Ukraine. The whole discussion about which type of armament to supply to Ukrainians, whether the Germans were actually doing enough by providing all those helmets in the beginning, or whether they should provide tanks instead, that discussion is based on, is a capability-based discussion, but which is legitimized by an idea that if you provide a particular number of artillery shells, a particular type of tank, if you provide those aircrafts, then we can promise that up. So the whole discussion is basically a discussion about whether it is true that by giving Leopard 2 tanks to the Ukrainians, they will be able to win in an offensive. So in many ways, this repeats a way we have been discussing the use of military force for a number of years, but it also harks back to a kind of Cold War approach to military operations, which is actually all the way back to counting how many tanks the Red Army we discussed this yesterday, that the stuff NATO was doing during the 70s and the 80s, just counting how many tanks and artillery pieces would be on the other side of the Fulda Gap. That kind of argument has returned, but in a way where you can model it, where you are actually able to closely follow the way you are using artillery, the number of artillery shells you're using, and then model the need you would have from there. And much of this is based on the way AI has become central to the war fighting in Ukraine. Alice Karp, the CEO of Palantir, who is an AI-based analysis firm working for the military, but also for the private sector, has put it this way: our software is in the fight. The power of advanced algorithm warfare systems is now so great that it equates to having tactical nuclear weapons against an adversary with only conventional ones. The general public tends to underestimate this. Our adversaries no longer do. The stock market doesn't underestimate it either. Palantir's stocks has been rising with a remarkable trend since 2022. But the whole point of this is that the Ukraine war has not only provided a way to use existing AI system, which was developed in during the global war of terror, which was very much part of the remote war warfare system, it has also provided so much more data that these systems have been able to evolve into something new, something which Karp describes as advanced algorithm warfare systems. A lot of the initial Ukrainian ability to fight back the Russians was by many identified with exactly that ability to have better information provided by these systems. So National Defense Magazine described Ukraine as a living lab for AI warfare, a kind of maker space for a new kind of warfare where AI plays a different role. Of course, for all the fascination about that, all that much data the war is providing and how much better it makes those logistical and targeting systems run by AI, that only describes how to run operations. It doesn't describe how to win. And perhaps it's time to repeat General Petraeus's first question from 2003, where he asked me, looking at the invasion of Iraq, tell me how this ends. Interestingly, that is exactly the kind of stuff Palantir and other providers software are used for in the civilian and military sectors to explain to people how certain processes will end if you change parameter A, B, or C. This changes the discussion. I think there is an important risk management point. This that changes the discussion from being a discussion about whether the Ukrainian armed forces would be able to prevail with if they got 1,000 more artillery shells a month, to a discussion about how you can manage the risk of conducting the itself by defining the conditions of victory. In other words, what kind of war do you need to fight in order to win it? It makes victory a question, a state of affair to be discussed, rather than that simple result which Dave Hansen imagined, either you win or you don't. Decisiveness becomes a discussion. To what extent would a certain outcome, would a Ukrainian victory where Crimea was still on Russian hands be a victory or not? Would it be a victory to the West, or would it be a victory to the government in Kyiv? And the discussion between the government in Kyiv and its allies quickly became centered around wargaming on the basis of the numbers produced by the software from Palantir and others. In March of 2023, high-ranking U.S. military officer Smith with their Ukrainian counterparts in Ramstein wargaming the rest of the war, or at least the coming offensive, based on the premise that he actually had the data to be able to model potential Ukrainian progress, but also making those models a way of discussing how to actually proceed the war. And when the Ukrainians apparently decided to do the opposite of what the American generals had recommended, then the political and military leadership in Washington also were quite quickly in summer of 2003 to go to the press to explain how the failing Ukrainian offensive certainly wasn't the way in which the Americans had advised the Ukrainians to proceed. They would have done otherwise, of course, implying that if the Ukrainians decided to do so, then they would have won at least a battle or two. So that's one element of the risk management done by modeling. Another element is the way in which the risk of escalation, which has been a very large part of how and why and to what extent to intervene in the Ukraine war, has been a question of risk management which could somehow be modeled. Some of this could be modeled more closely than others. A recurrent theme in the conflict has been Russian threats to use nuclear weapons, a threat which is hard to model. But which nevertheless has been an important part of the way in which the Western discussion about how much we could be engaged in the conflict without stepping over some kind of Russian red line, resulting perhaps in a nuclear confrontation. So there has been one type of risk assessment: how much can we contribute to the Ukraine war effort and then still deliver the results we would like to? And on the other hand, the risk of that very contribution escalating the war. So in risk management terms, the Western approach to this has been defined by a number of risk calculus, some of them easy to model, others based on assumptions about what the Russians will do. And in those risk calculations, we basically see a repetition of the remote warfare intervention system, which the West developed during the post-Cold War period. And I would argue that basically the Western intervention in the Ukraine war, though it is so very different from the war in Iraq and Afghanistan and other military interventions in the last 20 or 30 years, follows some of the same logics and some of the same focus on risk management as has been the case for the last 20 years. And perhaps the most important of these is the way in which remote warfare allows the West to get as much or as little war as we desire. We can endlessly discuss, and these discussions are, of course, going on right now between Berlin and Paris, how much we would like to be engaged in that conflict, what kind of victory would be okay for us, or if victory is the goal at all, while at the same time, the Ukrainian side seem, for obvious reasons, are much more focused on recovering lost territory, and by that we end up in much of the same discussion that the West has been in with the societies in which we have intervened during the last 20 years, that the goal between the people who are actually doing the fighting and the goals set by those far away in Washington, London, Paris or Berlin is very different. And a very much part of managing the conflict is to manage those different perspectives and different set of goals for the conflict itself. But it also means that what the West is very good at and what is basically at the center of that positive narrative I was talking about in the beginning is on a continual basis to supply artillery shells, armored personnel carriers, training military officers. And in the last 20 years, we have developed many ways of setting the logistics for supplying that stuff and training people up. And the discussions about how to do that in Ukraine is a question of scale rather than quality. But as we have experienced in those remote wars in the last 20 years, that also means that it becomes an everyday quality to the strategy of these operations, that you continue to do the same things over and over, sometimes in a belief that repetition is actually what will produce outcome. That is one of the points of counter-insurgency strategy, that if you keep doing it long enough, it might work. But in this context, then it suddenly becomes a discussion about whether you're able to keep up supplying a certain number of artillery rounds each month, whether you are able to train a certain number of Ukrainian troops. And in that discussion of how to be able to support Ukrainian operations, however important that might be, there is a real risk that you end up in formulating a way for doing operations rather than formulating strategic objectives for winning. I think we are developing ways in which we can support Ukraine for the next 40 years rather than developing a way in which the Ukrainians could win the war in the next 4 months. So to sum up, I think the argument that Western support for Ukraine constitutes something new as something going forward, it is, and I think it is a shock for many in continental Europe that conventional warfare has returned. But behind that new commitment and behind the shock of conventional war in Europe, there are many more continuities in Western strategies than perhaps immediately meets the eye. In terms of technology, the West has been supplying Ukraine, or Ukraine has developing for itself, remote warfare capabilities. And by doing so, the West has been able to transfer much of the risk of conducting the war to the Ukrainians themselves. The war has been institutionalized, as was our remote wars in the last 20 years, where a large part of the energy used in Western Europe and the United States to support this conflict
focusing on how to do it in a way where NATO and the EU would continue to stick together, rather than perhaps focusing on how most effectively win the conflict. There's the focus on humane warfare. I think one of the interesting features of the war in Ukraine so far is that Western public opinions have been hasn't been all that skeptical about our side. What has been a factor in most remote wars, the West has, or not as remote wars, the West has been fighting for the last 20 years, is that an important part of the risk that had to be managed was the risk that that Western publics would opt out because they felt that the warfare was conducted in a way which were against humanitarian laws or civilian values, if you want to put it that way. We have seen that discussion in the conflict in Gaza, which of course is very different from what's happening in Ukraine, but most of that discussion has been concentrated there. There's been very little of it in context of what is happening in Ukraine. I would predict that a lot of when eventually fighting in Gaza winds down, a lot of the same type of questions would be asked of the war in Ukraine. Those questions have already rightfully been asked of what the Russians are doing. But I think that introspection, which was so typical of Western wars for the last 20 years, will also seep into our Ukraine debate, making providing one more risk to be managed. And another characteristic of the Western engagement in the Ukraine war is, as I mentioned, modeling and algorithmic warfare. And of course, algorithmic warfare is not new. It is a product. It is software developed as a part of the global war on terror. But the scale, the number of data points which the Ukrainian war has provided for people writing that software has been so immense that in and of itself will change the quality of those programs. And it has also demonstrated the way in which the data provided by these programs can be used not only in staff work, but also used at the very tip of the spear. Obviously, one of the premises for remote warfare intervention system has been low budgets. And I think that there seems to be a fragile Western consensus at the moment that defense budgets should go up. It seems less clear what kind of capabilities those increased budgets are to support. It certainly isn't the remote warfare, or not exclusively at least, the remote warfare model capabilities. There is that focus on more conventional capabilities. But a risk to be managed is actually what lessons for Western procurement can be learned from the war in Ukraine. A large part of the NATO debate is how many shell producing factories should each country have after the end of the Ukraine war? And that might not be the best way to put together a portfolio for your shopping list for new capabilities. It might actually be a way of investing in past capabilities rather than new ones. And lastly, the focus on managing operations in order to minimize risks make a lot of political sense. And it also make military sense in the sense that from an organizational point of view, continuous operations are easier to organize, man, you can keep going. And all organizations like operations that can keep going. And in a war, as the one which is currently being fought in Eastern Ukraine, the ability to keep going is actually an important part of winning. But it's not a goal in and of itself. And there's a real risk that by applying the remote warfare model to the Ukraine war, the West has in many ways set itself up for a war which will be able to go on, if not forever, then for a very long time. And then of what would be really impressive, that is to provide a strategy which would actually help you. Looking very much forward to discussing this with you. I'm sure there's a lot of this which can be discussed much more.
Questions?
I'll get the questions started. So I find what you're saying quite convincing, and it does sort of seem like the West is focusing on minimizing risk and kind of buy into your argument. But as with all kind of behavioral economic approaches, and I'm very, very skeptical and think they always tend to kind of miss the black swans. I mean, surely this all works as long as Ukraine can keep supplying the troop numbers. And that, I think, is not quite so clear at the moment, especially the morale in the Ukrainian side with troops who have not been on any leave in 2 years is also seriously problematic. So does the algorithmic approach and the risk management approach also kind of create these lenses where we kind of ignore the political?
Yes, next person. I think you're completely right. Which is exactly the same mistake we made in Afghanistan, assuming that what was really important was our ability to sustain operations rather than the host government's ability to create a society which people would actually fight for. And of course, Ukraine is a very different country with very different problems. But our approach actually isn't. And the argument you are making are in many ways the way generals and politicians has been arguing in Kyiv, saying this is all well and good, but if you kind of supplied this stuff a bit earlier, then we might be able to use it at a point where we are actually able to keep fighting. But because the Ukrainians are forced to make their requests for raw material or political support or whatever within this risk management paradigm, they kind of have to sell to us that they are able to sustain operations forever. Because otherwise, it follows from this way of arguing that there's no way to for us to keep going because we can see we can't continue the operations. So there's something about the timelines, and I think that is an important point to make.
Thank you.
But it seems to me, following on from that, that Petraeus's quote from 2003 was talking about strategy.
Yeah.
And whether this was algorithmic warfare, or conventional warfare, or frankly any other type of warfare, it seems that it's a strategy that's clearly lacking. We should come to in your last point.
Yeah, yeah.
But had this been another type of war, is your thesis essentially saying that they would have approached strategy in a different way, or is it really just not about the way of them, it's just that West doesn't make strategy that is coherent and lasting anymore?
I think in many ways, I think basically you're right, but if I may elaborate a little bit on why you're right. In many ways, it's termed off the way the unfolded, right? I mean, Because the Ukrainians were able to repel the Russians in that initial attack, that set up the stage for a longer conflict, and that fitted this very well. So our basic assumption weren't on that one as challenged as much as they would have been if the war had unfolded. But I think a question which is perhaps more difficult to ask is whether if we had been thinking more strategically and with a different time frame, as you indicated, would we then have provided a different set of capabilities much sooner to the Ukrainians, which perhaps then would have enabled them to fight in a different way? I mean, we are shaping their way of fighting in the paradigm we can support. So we would only deliver missiles or tanks daily, which were at least one would argue was too late for the Ukrainians to conduct the operations they wanted to.
But I'm not sure that was because of a military calculation that we can't give them missiles and missiles now. that feels to me more because there was not the political acceptance that we get the nice toys out of the cupboard at the start. And we think they're going to, you know, just stop the Russians without us having to dig too deep. And certainly if I look back at the three campaigns you're talking about, the way they were each begun was really quite different. You know, Iraq was very certainly a war of choice. And arguably Afghanistan was a response to an attack by someone else. This again is, you know, a state attack on a different country. So each one to me is different. But to me, the similarity between them is the strategy, or lack of strategy, that defines that that victory, rather than seeking victory from individual battles.
Which I think is true, but I think a part of the explanation for why it's that way is that that you end up in focusing on your ability to do stuff rather than your desire to achieve a certain
I'm fascinated by the data sharing. Could you tell us a bit more about that? So what kind of data is being shared? Who owns it? How secure is it?
As I understand, perhaps an interesting subplot. I mean, one interesting way to look at what's actually important in military operations is what is the most secret. While you have seen plenty of pictures of artillery shells rolling into Ukraine, this stuff is much more behind wraps. A lot of what we know is based on corporate propaganda, basically. So. Within that framework, it seems like fairly early on, Western intelligence services and private contractors were able to get access to almost all data points which were available in Ukraine, from footage from cameras at the border where you could count the number of trucks going over, to individual citizens providing videos to scraping Facebook or the other internet platforms where Russian soldiers had been so careless to put geo data on their photos and all that kind of stuff. And what algorithmic warfare or algorithmic capabilities has been developed to do is basically to gather as many information points as possible, correlate them, and then identify targets on the basis of that. And while I'm sure EU's GDPR rules are perhaps not followed entirely when you do that, it seems like at least for the first year and a half, the Ukrainians were able to identify targets at a pace and with an accuracy which the Russians were completely unprepared for. It seems like the Russians have become a bit more clever and perhaps developed capabilities approaching this themselves. But that, a lot of that initial advantage was, I think, crucial for the Ukrainian war. And that is, as I pointed out, basically a risk management tool, right? How difficult is it to identify a target or identify the logistical point bottlenecks in Russian operation? So it is very traditional military issues, which you can get more information on at a much higher speed. So it is fascinating stuff.
I just wanted to follow up on that. When I was looking at this, how, I mean, your account is really fascinating, how Ukraine has become a lab on many domains in technology, other things, I mean, the strategies and all that. So we're just thinking, this also gives a lot of time to Russia, as just you say, to become more clever, right? And to respond. So is the Western alliance evaluating that? Because it also happened in other places, like Taliban also got clever, right? In order how to fight, you know, it was just, at the beginning, it was very asymmetrical, the Western alliance against Taliban, but we know what happened. So is the Western alliance evaluating that? Because they're also developing their own ways of responding and also the war industry, strategy, technology, and all that.
Yeah,
I think a very public version of that interrogation is the row between the German Chancellor and the French President. You can follow the media at the moment, where the French President is basically calling the German Chancellor a coward because he don't want to engage more in Ukraine. And I think that is, we recognize that kind of debate from Iraq and Afghanistan. Why won't you send more troops? Why are we supposed to be taking all the cash flows while you guys just staying in safe spaces and so on? And that is a repeat of that discussion, just in a at least strategically much more volatile and arguably serious context. The interesting part of that links to your question is that when you conduct that algorithm, then you have much more data to evaluate. And you are also able to model on the basis of that data what will happen in the next 6 months. What kind of operations are we able to do? If we know what the targets are and where they're placed and how much ammunition we have. And of course, no one has allowed me into that particular meeting room in Brussels. But I'm pretty sure that a basis for the discussions of what the alliance is going to do next is basically analysis which are based on that data which comes out of the algorithmic warfare, which of course is great and gives you more information and so on, but it also kind of creates a trap because that means that we end up measuring our success on the basis of what we can measure. And what we can measure is this operational capability. Measuring strategic success is that anyone who has ever picked up a volume of force which would know, much more difficult and based on completely different factors. So there are some, I think there's a risk that strategy ends up being kind of an organizational safe space, where we will only deal with the data we know, not with all the, which is a much larger risk of actually not engaging in a way where you can actually, provide the satisfaction.
So that's sort of interesting, and building on from that, is it almost seems as though in order to be successful in strategy, there needs to be a leap of faith, where you move away from what the numbers are telling you to what you want your desired end goal to be. Can you think of where there have been good examples of people actually doing that leap of faith? Like, where is it that seemingly we became less prone to move away from that? And how do we maybe bring that back in? If at the end of the day, that's what we need to be developing, is sort of an acceptance of taking that leap.
Well, I'm certainly not making an argument for just doing stupid things and saying, well, it works. But I think I am making an argument for being aware that if you're just always focusing on what can go wrong, what you can safely do, and so on, then you won't be able to succeed, because then warfare becomes something you produce. It's a conveyor belt of military results and it results in something. And sometimes war works that way. But much more often, I find general machine is basically about assessing risks and saying, okay, this is the best we can do. That it is basically about training risks, risk of not doing anything, risk of doing this, risk of doing that, and then at a certain point you say, okay, this is the best we can do, and let's see whether that works. If you never really go there, then I think that is the risk of actually producing systems which are so safe and well monitored and based on data that the active can't really provide they're supposed to be providing, which is some kind of results. But hey, I mean, as you indicate, there's a balance to be struck between just saying that producing results is just doing something, because that of course is a risk.
Do you
touch
one more? At what level is ownership of these capabilities held? So we notice that platoon, you know, really low level sections have access to drones these days. Mm. But where is the, I assume it's right at the top, right?
Interestingly, that is something which is very difficult to get a clear answer on. I have a theory, but I think what these systems, from a theoretical point of view, if you look at how those such systems operate, then one of the beauty of them is that they are distributed. And it doesn't really matter who has the, AI systems like this doesn't need to be central in order to function. They can be distributed because you can distribute data between different points. So it's basically it is possible to have at least theoretically you can construct those systems. So even the sergeant in the front would have access to how the Ukrainian army is actually doing it. I really don't.
Thank you. I really enjoyed it and the conversation afterwards as well. It seems to me that the idea of decisive victories would speak to essentially escalation, early upgunning of all our capabilities. Mm. But I think that from what I see in the press, there is also a very strong reason for suppressing a new sort, which is if we believe anything of the Russian response, it will go nuclear. Mm. Then I think the politicians are probably managing what they see as the main risk in that space. And so does that change the calculus, whether we think about way of war or the risk to becoming nuclear? Does that change the way we look at AI and this?
But interestingly, in one of the quotes from Carl Dillinger's, he is comparing algorithmic warfare to tactical nuclear.
You mentioned it,
and if that's the case, at what point would that capability be so important that we were actually escalating beyond that red line?
But doesn't that suggest that maybe you need to win the victory slowly, so it doesn't look so obvious that you're about to win victory until the moment that you do?
Yeah.
Rather than that you've gone all out, and maybe that is what.
And that would work if the political commitment kept
seeing this state the cap. Yeah.
And then we are back to all the problems we've been discussing for the last 20 years.
Yeah, thank you very much. Well, thank you, Chris, governing for algorithms. So I really enjoyed it and also the discussion later on. So thanks again for coming. It was great. And thanks again.
Well, thank you for having me.